Mother Nature
I am going to get married again. I am going to marry Horace Van de Gelder for his money and send it circulating among the people like rainwater the way you taught me. And I want a sign from you sometime today that you approve. Oh, it won't be a marriage in the sense that we had one, but I will certainly make him happy. And Ephraim, I'm tired. I am tired of living from hand to mouth. So I want that sign.
Mrs. Levi.
Sometime today. Don't worry, Mr. Kemper. We'll make that train. We'll get to Yonkers. You'll marry Ermengarde. Leave everything to me. For when I spike it a little, some young prime has kissed a little.
House without a woman is inadequate. dishout. And pretty dirty, too!
It takes a woman all powdered and pink to joyously clean out the drain in the sink. And it takes an angel with long golden lashes and soft as the fingers washed up in the ashes. Now look here, Mrs. Levi, you introduced me to Mrs. Malloy, and rumors are not, I ain't
did call in on her this afternoon, as arranged.
Very well, then there's nothing more for me to do here but go back to New York and tell the other girl, the heiress, not to wait.
Wait, whoa. What do you mean?
Nothing. A word. Heiress.
Oh, my God. What's her name? Her name?
Her name? Money. Ernestina Money.
Oh, what a lovely name.
Oh, picture, if you will. Hair as shiny as a newly minted dime. Eyes as big and as round as silver dollars. Skin as soft and as mossy as an old greenback.
Oh, I can feel her now.
Age 19, weight 102, waist 47.
Waist 47?
Well, that's with money belt. Now, I can arrange to have you meet this Ernestina this very afternoon.
I haven't got time, Mrs. Levi. I gotta take my niece, Mary God, to the office this afternoon until she forgets a certain Ambrose Kemper.
I can do that for you, Mr. Van Gelder. I know just how to handle such things.
Oh, then I can march in a 14th Street parade.
What a coincidence. Guess who was chosen to ride the main float? The spirit of 14th Street. Miss Money. Her mother was a cash, you know.
Okay, I'll be there to meet Miss Money at the parade, but I still intend calling on Mrs. Malloy first.
Well, the races you would have me run. Very well, then, Mr. Vandegelder. I will meet you on that bench in front of Mrs. Malloy's hat shop at 2:30, as usual.
Wait a minute. What if I decide against Mrs. Malloy, and I don't like Miss Money, neither?
Well, then I happen to have one more name on my list. A name I know as well as my own. But that'll come up by itself all in good time. Oh, but wait till you see Ernestina Harris. A vision. A dream.
It takes some woman all powdered and pink to joyously take down the train.
Promoted from chief clerk to chief clerk. And if I'm lucky in 10 years, I'll be promoted to chief clerk again. 33 years old and I don't get an evening free. When am I gonna live?
You can live on the holidays, Cornelius.
Did you forget what we did last Christmas? All those canned tomatoes went bad and exploded and you and I cleaned up the mess all afternoon. You call that living?
No, I guess not.
Finally, you and I are going to New York.
You mean close the store?
But Cornelius,
we can't.
We'll have to. Some more rotten tomato cans are going to explode.
Holy kaboos, how do you know?
I'm gonna light this candle under them, that's how I know. They'll make such a smell, customers won't be able to come into the shop for 24 hours. That is just speaking for you. Barnaby, going to New York and we're gonna live. We're gonna have a good meal. We're gonna be in danger. We're gonna spend our money. We're gonna be arrested.
Oh, my goodness.
One more thing, Barnaby. We ain't coming back to Yonkers until we've each kissed a girl.
But, Cornelius! You can't do that. You don't know any girls.
Barnaby, I'm 33 years old. I gotta begin sometime.
Yeah, but I'm only 17. It isn't so urgent for me.
Barnaby, New York, elevated trains, the lights of Broadway, the stuffed whale at Barnaby Museum.
Stuffed whale?
Stuffed whale, Barnaby, what do you say?
Yes, Cornelius, yes!
Now, the first have to do is make you financially independent. I know. I'll find you a job. Can you dance?
I'm an artist, Mrs. Levi. I paint.
What am I hiring?
Mrs. Dolly Levi, painters taught how to dance.
Now, there is this man, Rudolph Riesenweber, at the Harmonia Gardens restaurant on 14th Street. I'll give you a note for him. And we'll see if he can't enter you both in the polka contest this evening. The first prize is a week's engagement and a solid gold cup. The cup we won, Ephraim and me.
Now, hold on, Mrs. Levi. No fiancé of mine has just set foot in the cafe.
Oh,
and I don't mind saying, I'm surprised that you have acquaintances in a place like that.
Not acquaintances, Mr. Kemper, friends. Dear friends of days gone by, my late husband, Ephraim Levi, always believed in love. And any place you could get it, cafe, ballroom, yes, even in theaters. Every Saturday night, even when times were bad, like hot milk, down those stairs at the Harmonia Gardens restaurant, we came Ephraim and Mickey.
Well, it's all very well to come down like clockwork, Mr. Levi, but you're asking Ernie Barr to work there.
Now, it is the only way to show Horace Vandegelder that we mean business. Now, you go to the Harmonia Gardens restaurant this very afternoon. Oh, and you tell them that Mrs. Levi sent you. And incidentally, tell her about that Dallas is coming back. And I want a table for two and a chicken for 8 o'clock tonight.
All right, Venus, the top one looks okay. Now hold it under the bottom row. Hold it! It looks like it's about ready to bust! Holy combustion, Cornelius! I can smell it up here!
Come on, Barnaby, let's get dressed. We're going to New York.
Oh, Jenny, why have I decided to marry Horace Vandergelder? Oh, Mr. Malloy! Why, I didn't ask you that. Well, I heard a guy in the restaurant ask this personal question. But as long as you did bring it up, I'm marrying Horace Vandergelder for one reason and one reason alone. To get away from the millinery business, I take tax. Oh, Mrs. Malloy! And I can no longer stand being suspected of being a wicked woman. There's nothing to show for it.
Oh, no, Mrs. Malloy!
Oh, don't protest me. All millineresses are suspected of being wicked women. Why, that's why I can't go to a ball or a restaurant or a theater. Why, that's all the proof they need. Take my word for it, Minnie. Either I marry Horace Vandergelder or I break out of this place like a fire engine. Oh, not Miss Mortimer again. Miss Mortimer, I'll take care of it. No, Minnie, you can make another hat for Miss Mortimer if you like. I'm going to wear this one myself.
Oh, Mrs. Malloy, why, you can't. Why, you're a widow in that hat. Well, it's provocative. That's what.
Well, who knows? Make him into the shop today. And provocative may be just what I want to be.
Oh, Mrs. Malloy.
Oh,
Once is enough for a woman, as long as it's true love. And it was that. Minnie, look, there's two gentlemen staring at the shop.
Men?
And I do believe they mean to come in here.
Men? In the shop? Oh, Mrs. Malloy, what shall we do?
Do? Why, flirt with them, of course. I'll give you the younger one.
Oh, Mrs. Malloy, you and all that talk about love.
Not enough I've had, Minnie. It's a bit of adventure I can do with now. We'll get them all heated up and then drop them cold. It'll be good practice for married life. Now, you run into the workroom. I know some ways we can cook up our appearances. And a little weight will only make them a little more eager.
Do you say that?
Yeah.
comes. I mean, when I make an appointment, I like people to be on time. Here, here's a present for you. Chocolate-covered peanuts, unshelled. That's the expensive kind. Did I just see you talking to two men?
Men, Mr. Vandergelder, what would men be doing in a lady's hat shop? Now, I don't need to come into my workroom. I'm so anxious for you to see me.
I saw it last week.
So you did? How are things in the Hayes feed business? I hear you have
some... What on earth are you talking about?
Yonkers. I hear some news from me.
And who's been telling you about Yonkers, may I ask?
Nobody else. The friend.
What friend? Did you say Hackle?
Why, yes.
He just happens to be my chief clerk, that's all. Mrs. Malloy, I demand an explanation.
And I'm going to give you one. Now, why shouldn't she know Cornelius Hackle? Everyone in New York knows Cornelius Hackle. Why? He's here at the opera. He's an all fashionable host. Why, he's at the Harmonia Garden restaurant 3 times a week.
Impossible. He's only got $146.35, and I keep it in my own safety.
You are killing me, Mr. Vandergelder. He is one of the Hackles. They built the canal.
What canal?
The canal. Both.
It ain't the same man.
Out from Jenny Lynn's carriage and bowled her through the streets. Cornelius Hackle, who, dressed as a waiter, dropped an oyster down Mrs. Astor's. Well, I couldn't say, but it was Cornelius. Now he is the playboy of New York. I mean, don't deny it. You were taken with him just like everyone else.
Oh, Dolly, I've only just met him. I mean, really, Dolly.
Excuse me.
Of course.
Mrs. Levi, stand aside.
No man, indeed. And you will make short work of any man. I can see no muscles underneath your coat. Between back and forth, ripple.
Mrs. Levi, for the last time, will you stand aside?
Stand, indeed. And that is exactly what the court will want to know. When you are accused of entering this closet without a search warrant. What do you stand for, if you don't stand for the laws of this great land?
I know what I stand for.
I stand for motherhood, America, and a hot lunch for orphans. Take off your hat, sir, and drop the flag and pass it through.
Thank you. in that closet. God bless you.
Mrs. Malloy.
Oh, right, Mr. Vandergill, there is a man in that closet.
Uh-huh. What?
Good Lord, the whole place is crawling with men. I don't think I'll ever get over it. Well, I take it I will see you later this afternoon, Mr. Vandergelder.
You certainly will, Mrs. Levi, with a certain young lady on the main float at the end of the parade. Good day, Mrs. Malloy.
Mrs. Malloy, I can explain everything.
I don't want to hear any more explanations. Just you and Mr. Tucker give me the pleasure of getting out of my shop, or I send for Officer Bogart.
Now, well, sending for an officer is letting them off much too easy, I mean. Now, I have been studying the offenses that these two have committed, and I believe that you have ground for at least two writs.
Oh.
A non compos mentis. And a guarantee. But the main thing is to try to show that you settled it amicably first. Have dinner with them.
Dinner?
Oh, that's absolutely necessary.
Well, it's the way things are done in the law, I mean. Dinner first, guarantee afterwards.
Yes, it must be. All right, Mr. Tucker, Mr. Hackle, you may take Miss Fay and myself to dinner.
Delighted, Mrs. Malloy. I speak for Barney, too. Now, I hear there's a very nice restaurant in the railway station.
Oh, no. If the Harmonia Gardens restaurant is good enough for your friends, it's good enough for us. I hear they have a lovely orchestra there, Minnie.
Oh, we couldn't go there, Mrs. Malloy. It's not the money or anything like that. It's the whale. The whale. No, Barney, it's not the whale. It's the dancing. You see, they have dancing in a place like that. Contests, even exhibitions. And I don't know how. It would take me weeks, months, years to learn. Mrs. Dolly Levi, 33-year-old clerk, taught how to dance.
Now it is very simple, Mr. Hatton. You put one hand here and one hand here.
It absolutely won't move. They have no sense of rhythm.
Oh, absolutely no sense of rhythm is a primary requirement for learning by the Dowling-Levi method. Now, you just give me 5 minutes of your time, Mr. Hathor, and I will have you dancing in the street. Now, let's start with lesson 7 as the waltz takes turn. Now, right foot touch, left foot touch, back, under, around, and touch. Back, under, around, behind. Open, out, release, unfurl. Wonderful, Mr. Hackle. When I think of all those rhythms that will find heaven in your arms. Let's go back to lesson 1. Put your hat on her waist and dance. With her right in your left hand. And 1, 2, 3, 1, 2, 3, 1, 2, 3, 1.
I'm dancing.
Of course you are, Mr. Hackle. Take the someone who's on your wrist. Hold on to her tight and spin and 1, 2, 3, 1, 2, 3, 1, 2, 3.
Let's go to this place and together polish the flare. The world.
remember. It's been a long time since you lived here, Mrs. Levi. Such a long, long time.
Ethel, let me go. It has been long enough, Ethel. For all these years, I have put out the cat, I've locked the door, I've made myself a little rum toddy. And then before going to bed, I say a prayer, thanking God for my independence and that no one else's life was mixed up with mine. And then one night, an oak leaf fell from my Bible. I placed it there when you asked me to marry you. A perfectly good oak leaf, only without life and without color. And I suddenly realized that I was like that oak leaf, that for years I hadn't shed a tear, or I hadn't been filled with the wonderful hope that something or other would turn out well. And Ethel, I have decided to rejoin the human race. And I want you to give me away before the race passes by. I want to get some steps while there's still time left before the race passes by. I want to get some.
Yeah. Mrs. Levi, what is the meaning of this?
But she said she'll meet you tonight at the Harmonia Gardens restaurant.
That's the most expensive restaurant in the city.
And well, it should be front food and the fastest waiters in New York. Now, I might be a little late, so Miss Money will meet you in front of the restaurant and we'll wait till you see her heart in that lovely feather boa and humming it old-fashioned too. Now, yes, sweet Rosie O'Grady, you couldn't miss her if you tried.
All right, Dolly, I'll be there. But only because I already paid for the introduction, I might as well get my money for it. But from this point on, you are hereby discharged as my marriage broker, is that clear? From now on, Dolly Levi, you're just another woman, like any other woman.
Ephraim, he's as good as mine. I've got a razor.
Yeah.
gentlemen, but are you going to escort us in?
Of course we are, Mrs. Molloy. Carly!
Mrs. Molloy?
Yes, Mr. Hackle?
As we start inside, may I...
Yes, Mr. Hackle?
May I put my arm around your waist?
Yes, Mr. Hackle. But I must warn you, a corset is a corset.
$2.
like chill.
Why didn't you say so? Here, I'm on your bed.
Promise you won't order anything else.
Give this to the band leader. Come to play a nice waltz.
Excuse me. Could you give this nickel to the band leader and tell him to play? I know it's mine, because all I need is a dollar, three dimes, five pennies, and Cornelius. Cornelius! Oh! Cornelius! Did he say two pennies? Make it three! Four! Better than the house! And never mind if I don't see the well. I'll have one of my own!
Stop! Stop! That's what he's shoving for, boy. I told you before, no shoving! This is the Arbonia.
Beautiful lady with golden blonde hair and the biggest hello.
Excuse me, dearie. Dolly? Dolly Levi, what are you doing in that ghetto? And you're a half hour late. And I demand an explanation of?
Ernestine.
Exactly.
Ernestine, oh, my trusted.
She wanted to do the Gucci Gucci.
Well, Shelly was artistic. Her husband had our table break down in front. There's one dancer in the competition. I particularly like you to see. Rudolph, pull our table in front. What have you ordered?
What you wanted, a chicken. Now, Mrs. Levi,
a chicken? Did you say a chicken? Oh, I don't think I could eat a chicken, not after what's happened.
Good, you canceled the chicken.
Oh, Rudolph, bring a turkey.
What are you doing now?
Oh, nothing, just looking the place over, getting acquainted with my surroundings.
That's the trouble with you, Dolly. Always sticking your nose into other people's affairs. Anybody who wouldn't marry you would be as nervous as a cat.
What? What did you say?
I said anybody who'd marry you would be as nervous as a cat.
Harris Vandegelder, you get that idea out of your head right this minute. I'm surprised you would even mention such a thing. I have no intention of marrying you.
I didn't mean that.
Well, I certainly do hope not. You go your way, Harris, and I will go mine. I am not some ivory Malloy whose head is turned with a few chocolate-covered peanuts. I am shells.
Mrs. Levi, you misunderstood me.
Well, I certainly do hope not, but if I had an intention of marrying again, it would be to a far more pleasant, loving man than yourself. However, let's not talk about it. Here comes the waiter with our food. Now, Harris, as I said, you go your way and I'll go mine. Just start raising on the line. I think it'll make you feel better at once. Since you brought the matter up, there's one thing I think I ought to say.
I didn't bring the matter up at all.
One thing I ought to say before we forget about it. Now, it is true I'm a woman who likes to know everything that's going on, who likes to manage things, but I will not manage anything as out of control as your household. You'll have to do that by yourself, God helping you.
It is not out of control.
Very well, then I won't say another word about it. Here, have some beets. They're good.
I don't like beets.
That's good. Is no source of companion for me. You solve your beef, and I will solve mine.
Will you stop saying that?
Very well, then I won't say another word about it.
Good.
Except this. Now, at your age, Horace, you should enjoy hearing the honest truth.
My age? You're always talking about my age.
Well, I don't know what your age is, but I do know that up in Yonkers with bad food and bad temper, you're bound to double it in 6 months. Now, here, have some beets. They're good.
I don't like beets. I hate beets.
That's what, just dig right in. No, the pity of it is that you could be a perfectly charming, witty, amiable man if you wanted to.
I don't want to be charming.
But you are. I mean, look at you now. Now, you can't deny it. Now, sit down. We'll talk about something else. Before I change the subject, there's one more thing I want to say.
I don't want to hear it. And for the last time, Dolly Levi, I will not ask you to marry me.
Well, I suppose that means that you want me to ask you? Well, Harris, I'm sorry. I'm turning you down.
How can you turn me down? I haven't asked you anything.
Well, it's no use arguing. I've made up your mind. Now, here, let me cut your beef.
I go to heaven! I'm going back to my hotel.
You can't go now. The competition is about to begin.
Here's the money to pay for the dinner. Here's... Wait a minute. There's nothing in here but $1, 3 dimes, 5 pennies, and a button. This isn't my purse. I've lost my purse.
Rudolph, move our table right down in front so Mr. Bisuito
Well, now, you're all charged with disturbing the peace. Assault and battery, inciting to riot, and several other equally serious violations of the law of this city. Now, who is there here to speak on your behalf?
Can you come to me?
I say, who is there here to speak on your behalf? Dolly Levi.
Counselor at law.
Your Honor, the defense rests. Well, there's no reason to call any witnesses, ladies and gentlemen, when I look upon that bench and I see a brow that shines with honor. A nose. Ladies and gentlemen, look at that nose. Like a beacon in the night. Your Honor, would you turn this way a little bit more so we can get a better look at your beacon? Over here. Thank you. A living symbol of this great land, the Robocus Unum. Your Honor, I call for freedom for my client and a verdict of guilty for the only real culprit, Harris Van Gelder of Yonkers, New York.
Darling,
the one man responsible for the grievous offenses, the willful destruction of private property.
A foreign curtain, Bruce Winters, and a gold cup bed.
Cruelty.
A poor, unfortunate minor.
Would you mind repeating that, dear?
Miss Lee, please, the court, I have something to say.
Oh, go right ahead, Mr. Ken Hackle. I was just about to call you.
Cornelius Hackle, you dare testify against me, I'll discharge you.
You've already done that, Mr. Bender.
I'll do it again!
You've done it again, too. Even if you hadn't, I still have to say what I have to say. Your Honor, I don't know much about disturbing the peace or inciting to riot, but I do know that what happened to me today, which is the most important thing that could happen to a man, might have never happened if I had obeyed his orders and stayed in Yonkers, New York. Your Honor, talking about none other than the law.
What? You mean to tell me after 33 years of suddenly falling in love because you take one evening off?
Oh, no, Mr. Van Gelder, I didn't fall in love with Mrs. Irene Malloy of this city in just an evening, an hour. No, that's too long. What's less than a minute?
A second.
Less than that.
A moment.
That's it. I'll go slowly so you can get it all down.
It only takes a moment for your eyes to meet, and then your heart knows in a moment you my arm.
their eye, their forehead, they all come together up here. Kenyon, I tell you right now, a fine woman is the greatest work of God on earth. You can talk all you like about the pyramids or Niagara Falls, they're just not in it at all. You know, today I've lost a lot of things. I've lost a job. I've lost my future. I've lost everything that people think is important. Do you want to know something? I don't care. Even if I had to be a ditch digger for the rest of my life, I'm going to be a ditch digger for once in a wonderful day.
A few words back then. Right after, don't.
Goodbye. Don't try and stop me, Harry, please.
I didn't need you before, and I don't need you now. Dolly Levi, you're just another woman like any other woman. Dolly Levi, you go your way, and I'll go mine. Dolly. Dolly. Dolly.
You stamp, Mr. Van de Gelder?
Ah, so it's you, Mr. Hackle. Come crawling back, have you?
Oh, no, Mr. Van de Gelder. I just came back for my $145.36. You see, I decided to open my own business. Mrs. Hay and Pete is all I know. I'm opening my own store.
And Cornelius has found the perfect location. Right across the street from you.
Oh, so you think you can't compete with Van de Gelder, do you? Well, just you try. Oh, another one come crawling back. What do you want?
My back. My back pay for the last 4 months. $6.12.
You can't do this to me. Any of you. I'm going to record. I'll get lawyers. I'll.
Well, Harry Van de Gelder, as I live and breathe. Now, don't you look handsome? So few men nowadays have the courage to wear a flowered satin vest in a feed store. Oh, I know what you're going to say, that Ernestina didn't work out. Well, I found another... But wait a minute, I'm interrupting you. You were doing something. What were you doing?
Getting Cornelius' money. $145
and... $36.
And $6.12 a night.
And the money my mother left me.
$52.48.
38. 48. All right. All right. That's the money you want. It's in the safe upstairs.
Oh. Money, money, money. Mr. Van de Gelder's money. It's like the sun we walk under. It can either kill or cure. Van de Gelder never tires of saying, most people in this world are fools. And in a way, he's right, isn't he? Himself, Irene, Cornelius, myself, we're all fools. And we're all in danger of destroying the world with our folly. The only sure way to keep us out of harm is to give us the 4 or 5 simple human pleasures that are our right in this world. And that, my friend, takes a little money. The difference between a little money and no money at all is enormous, and it can shatter the world. And the difference between a little money and no money at all is very slight. But that too can shatter the world. It depends on how you use it. My late husband, Ephraim Levi, always said, money, pardon the expression, it's like manure. Well, it's not worth seeing unless you spread it around, encouraging young things to grow. Anyhow, that is the opinion of the second Mrs. Harris Van de Gelder. Oh, Ephraim, I'm ready for that sign. Well, Harris, as I was saying, I have found you the ideal wife.
Dolly, sit down. I don't need you to find me no ideal wife. If I want an ideal wife, I'll find one for myself. And I found one. And it's you, damn it.
Harris!
Oh, I know. I've been a fool about Mrs. Malloy and that other woman. Dolly, give me. Marry me.
Now, Harris, stop right there. Now, you know as well as I do that you are the first citizen of Yonkers, and that your wife has to be a somebody. Answer me. Am I a somebody?
You are. A wonderful woman.
Oh, Harris.
You're partial. No, no, it isn't enough that you shower your wife with jewels and money. And that you make her benefactress to half the town. Oh, and by the way, you know, it is not good business to have Cornelius open a store right across the street from yours. You bring him back and make him your partner.
Partner?
If that way Barnaby can have Cornelius' old job.
No.
Well, that way we can all be together and dance at Ermengarde's wedding.
Oh, no, that doesn't. Now you've gone too far. I do not dance at weddings. Besides, I don't know how to dance. It would take weeks, months, years.
I don't hear
you. Here, let me help you.
Thank you. they take pictures of her crying.